B'siyata d'shmaya, we're going to learn Tainis Daf Tezayin. We're going to start four lines from the top of the Omud. Rechoiv, Teva, Sakim, Efer, Efer, Kvura. And these are six halachas that are going to be associated to fast days. And then, by the way, Umayriya, the next one, the seventh one, is going to be something which is not really associated, according to Rashi, is not really associated to the fasting, to our topic, but since it's the same Chachomim that were discussing Moriah as discussed some of the others, it's brought here as well. Simon, that's a simon to remember the different halachas we're about to discuss. Says the Gemara, Lomo Yotzin L'Rochiv. We learned in the Mishnah that with the last set of fasts, the seven fasts at the end, they would take the Teva, where the Sefer Torah was held, and they would take it into the city square, and they would daven outside in public. So now the Gemara is asking, why would they go out to the Rechoiv, to the public square, to the city plaza, and take the Teva there? Why would they daven there? Says the Gemara, B'chir bar Abba Omar, Loimar, what they were trying to say is, that, so to speak, saying to Hashem, Zo'aknu b'tzino, we cried to Hashem, in privacy, inside our shuls, and we were not deserving of being answered. As we saw in the previous fasts, they would daven in the shuls. We're going to humiliate ourselves in public by going out into the public and expressing our pain and our begging Hashem to have mercy on us. And hopefully in that merit, our tefillahs will be answered. That's what Reb Chiya bar Abba said. Rish Lakish says, Golinu, that we've gone into a type of an exile by going out of our shuls, and Goluseinu mechaperes olenu, and we know that going into exile can act as an atonement, and obviously if the rain is not coming down, it's a sign that we have averus and we need to be atoned, and going into exile, so to speak, will be an atonement for us. Maybe now, what's the difference between the two explanations? It could be now. The difference is, says the Gemara, the Golumi Beiknishta le Beiknishta, if they would exile themselves from one shul and go to a different shul, then as far as exile is concerned, it would suffice. But as far as humiliating themselves in public, it would not suffice. V'lomo, this is the second halacha. V'lomo mitzienes hateva l'rochoivo shalir. Why would they take the ark, where the Sefer Torah was held, why would they take that out into the city square? We've explained why they themselves would go and daven outside, but why did they have to take the teva out? Omre b'shua ben Levi, loimar kli tzanua hoyolonu. They were expressing that we had a private vessel, which is what was holding the Sefer Torah. V'nizbaze ba'avineinu, and the privacy of this vessel has got degraded, consequent to our avirus. And this is a type of confession, a type of a vidui, which contributes to tshuva, and ultimately to be atoned. The third halacha, v'lomo miskasin besakin. Yerushalmi says it was custom that when they would fast, they would gird with sackcloth, and they would go to the Beis HaKvoros, and they would blow the horns, the shofaros. So the Gemara is asking, why would they gird, why would they cover themselves with sackcloth? Omer b'chia bar Abba, loimar, they were expressing, hari onu chashuvin kebehema, that we feel we're humble, and in some levels we're comparing ourselves to animals, and the same way as animals, take the hair of a goat. This sackcloth is made of the hair of the goat, so there's something in common with animals. And the Ben Ish Chai and Ben Yoyada says that the same way as you, Hashem, have mercy and pity on the animals, have pity on us too. The next halacha, v'lomo noisnim efer makle al gabe teva. We saw in the Mishnah that they would put ashes onto this teva. Why would they do that? Omer Rabbi Yehuda ben Pazi, kloima. What they were actually meant to be expressing with that was what it says in the Pasuk, Imoy Anoichi Batsara. The Pasuk says in Tehillim that, so to speak, Hashem, who is being represented by the vessel, by the ark, by the teva, holding the Sefer Torah, is with us in our pain, in our distress. Rish Lakish Omar. Rish Lakish brought a different Pasuk in Yeshaya, where the Pasuk says, Bekol Tzarosom Loitzar, with all our tzar, with all our distress, Hashem also, so to speak, feels our pain. Omar Abzera. Rav Zera says, Miresh, at the beginning, when I would see the Chachomim, that they would place ashes al gabe teva onto this teva, mizdazea li kule gufei, my whole body would tremble from this concept of, so to speak, Hashem being with us in our pain, in our distress. And it's clear from here that that was just Reb Zeira's initial response, but not something that lasted. The next halacha, b'lama noisnim eifer b'roish kol echod ve'echod. Why would they place ashes on the head of each and every individual? So there's a machlekes, pligi bar Reb Levi bar Choma v'Reb Chanina. Two chachomim argued, chad omar, one of them explained, because what they were actually expressing was, harei onu chashuvim lefanecha, we are considered to you ke'efer, like ashes, and this was an expression of humility in the hope that it would help them soften their hearts, mend their ways, and deserve atonement. The chad omar, the other chacham explained, k'dei sheyizkeru lanu afreish al Yitzchak, they wanted that the ashes they were putting on their foreheads should, so to speak, remind Hashem and reawaken the merit of Yitzchak Avinu, that he was prepared to be burnt as a korban. Avram Avinu was prepared to offer him as a korban. We know it didn't happen, but the very fact that they were prepared to do that, so to speak, there's a merit of ashes that represent Yitzchak Avinu, and in order to evoke that mercy, we put the ashes on our foreheads. My beinayu, the difference between the two explanations would be, ikka beinayu, offer stam, that in the event that you don't have, you should put on ashes. If you don't have ashes, is there any point in putting on earth? Then the answer is yes, because even though it will not remind, so to speak, it will not be a reminder for the ashes of Yitzchak Avinu, but it will be the humility of Onu Chashuvim Lefanecha Ke'efer that will be represented by the dust, by the earth that they would put on their foreheads. The next halacha, Loma Yoitzin the Beis HaKvoris. Why was it a custom to go to the Beis HaKvoris, to the graveyard on a fast day? Pligi bar Levi bar Choma. V'Reb Chanina, again, the same two chachomim argued, Chad Omar, one explained, Hare onu chashuvim lefanecho kemesim, that they were expressing that we're considered before you, Hashem, just like corpses, which is again an expression of humility. V'Chad Omar, kadei shivakshu aleinu meisim rachamim, in order that the deceased should daven for us and beg from Hashem mercy for us. My benayu, the difference between the two explanations will be, ikka benayu kivrei akum, that going to a graveyard where the agoyim are buried, according to the explanation that it was just an expression of humility, of anu chashuvim lefanecho kemesim, then that could apply also in a Beis HaKvoros of goyim, of akum. However, if we would go to the Beis HaKvoros in order to that the people buried there should daven on our behalf, well, the goyim don't even daven on their own behalf, never mind not on our behalf. Continues the Gemara, and this is the last of this series, and this is not a halacha that's associated to fasting, it's just that the same two chachomim, which is Reb Levi and Reb Chanina, were arguing regarding Har HaMoriah, so it's brought here as well. My Har HaMoriah, what is this Har HaMoriah? We know that Avram Avinu, when he did the Akedah, then he went to Eretz HaMoriah, he went to a place called Har HaMoriah. What is this Har HaMoriah? Why is it called Har HaMoriah? Pligi bar Reb Levi bar Choma, again, Reb Levi bar Choma is arguing Reb Chanina with Reb Chanina. Chad Omar, one explained, Har Sheyotzo Mimenu Hayro Li Yisrael, that the Har HaMoriah, which is the mountain on which the Beis HaMikdash is built, was a place where Hayroah, where instruction, where direction was offered to Klal Yisrael. It says, Ki Mitzion Teitze Teira, Teira goes out from Tzion. And we know the Lishkas HaGozis, the place where the Nevi'im would sit, and that's where Torah and Halacha and Teichocha, rebuke to mend the ways of Klal Yisrael, would come out from there, and that's why it was called Har HaMoriah. The Chadoma, the other explanation is, Har Sheyotzo Mimenu Moira Lo Ivdei Kechovim, that due to this mountain, to the Beis HaMikdash, then the Goyim would hear the greatness of Klal Yisrael, the Beis HaMikdash, Yerushalayim, and that will bring a certain awe and fear on the Goyim, that they will fear Klal Yisrael. That's the first explanation in Rashi, assuming that Har HaMoriah means the mountain on which the Beis HaMikdash, with the Har HaMoriah, the Har HaBayis. But Rashi brings a different explanation. The Har HaMoriah is actually referring to Har Sinai, and the Kornta explanation that it's Hayorah, that its instructions were given to Klal Yisrael, that's self-understood. We got the Torah on Har Sinai. And even the second explanation, that it's the place Sheyotzo Mimenu Moira, Lo'iv Dekechovim, that fear onto the Goyim came from this mountain. This was by when we got the Torah. Then there's Psukim that tell us that all the nations feared Klal Yisrael from that tremendous time and place where they got the Torah. Continues the Gemara. We saw in the Mishnah, Hazokin, Shebohem, the oldest of, we saw it in the Mishnah, in the Braisa, that the oldest amongst the people would, Omer Lefneim Divrei Kvushim, would say to them the words that would speak to their hearts and subdue their hearts and help them to do tshuva, to repent and be deserving of atonement. And then the rain would come down and they, whatever distress Klal Yisrael are in, they would pass. Tana Rabbanan, it says in a Braisa, Im Yesh Zokin, if there's an older person there, Oimer Zokin, it's the Zokin who should give that drosha. Im Lav, if there's no Zokin, Oimer Chochem, then a very wise and learned person should give the drosha. V'im Lav, and if there isn't a Chochem, Oimer Odom Shel Tzura, at least it should be a person of stature who should give the drosha. Where a person of stature is, it would make more sense and it's more probable that he will touch the hearts of the people and help them mend their ways. And now the Gemara interjects here and says, Otu Zokin to Ka'omri. When it mentions Zokin in the Braisa as our preferred choice for the person to give the Chizuk and the Joshua, the Divrei Kvushim, could that mean Afal Pi Delav Chochemhu? Could it mean even an Am Ha'aretz? Of course it cannot be that an older person who's an Am Ha'aretz would come before a Chochem to speak. Omar Abai explains, no, it doesn't mean that he's not a Chochem. No. Hochik Omar, what the Braisa meant was, Im Yer Zokin Vu Chochem, if you have somebody who is wise, who's a Chochem, and is also older, Oimer Zokin Vu Chochem, then this older person who's also very wise, he's the one that should give the drasha. V'im Lav, and if there isn't such a Chochem, then Oimer Chochem, then just a younger Chochem should give the drasha. V'im Lav, and if even that is not available, Oimer Odom Shel Tzura, it should be a person of stature who should say the words of Chizuk to the people. Now the Braisa continues, what was the nature of this drasha? He would say as follows, Achenu, my brothers, that's always the way to give rebuke. Start with an endearment. Start with something which is positive. Achenu, we're brothers. Lo yisak v'taynis girmim. It's not the sackcloth and the fasting which is actually going to be the cause of our tefillahs to be heard. Elo tshuva maisim tovim girmim. It's repentance and fixing our ways and good deeds which is going to cause our Hashem to atone us and accept our tefillahs. Shekein motzinu ba'anshei Nineveh, we saw that in Sefer Yonah, we read it on Yom Kippur every year, regarding the people of Nineveh. Shelo nemar behen, it doesn't say regarding the people of Nineveh, vayaro elikim esakom, that Hashem saw their sackcloth, estanisom, and their fasting. Elon, rather, what does it say in the Pasuk in Yonah Perigimel? Vayaro elikim es ma'asehem, Hashem saw their deeds, kishovu midarkom ora, that they have changed their ways and mended their ways. And now the Gemara is going to continue explaining a few other psukim over there in Yonah Perek Gimel. So that was Perek Yud. Now the Gemara is going back to, that was Perek Gimel Posuk Yud. Now we're going back to Perek Gimel Posuk Ches. The Posuk says there, Vaiskasu Sakim, that the people of Nineveh, they covered themselves with sackcloth, Ha'odom Vahaba'ema, also man and also the animals. So it seems that there was something in common here between the man and the animals. I mean, animals, they're always in sackcloth, their skin, that is, their skin is the sackcloth. May have a avdi. So it seems that there's something that people did here which involved the animals. What did they do? Says the Gemara, Osri habehema islechud vesavlod islechud. They separated the mothers from the offspring of the animals. Omru lefonov, they said to Hashem, Ribbono shel olam, Hashem, Im ein atom merachim oleinu, ein onu merachmin al elu. What they meant to say was that in the same way as you, Hashem, are telling us to have mercy even on these animals, as it says in Tehillim Kuf Mem Hei, v'racham oval kol maisov, so too you, Hashem, have mercy on us. Continues the Gemara. Again in the same pasuk, that after it says v'iskasu sakim ha'odom v'abheimo, it says v'yikru'u Elho Elohim, Bechozko. They cried out to Hashem, they called out to Hashem, Bechozko, with strength. They must have said something that had tremendous power. My Omur, what did the people of Nineveh say? Says the Gemara, Omru Lefonov, they said to Hashem as follows, Ribbonei Shel Olam, Oluv v'she'enei Oluv. If you have somebody who's much more tolerant, somebody who's able to hear things being said against him, to be behaved against him, and he can tolerate it more, namely you Hashem, v'she'enei Oluv, and people who don't have that level of tolerance, like us people. And similarly, tzaddik, when you have a tzaddik like you Hashem, v'rosha, and us, who we're obviously not, we're more wicked, we've done things wrong. Mi nitche mipnei mi. Who would commonly give in to who? Is it not the tzaddik would give in and come towards the rasha? Is it not the more patient and tolerant person that would be giving in to the less tolerant? And that's what they were saying to Hashem, you're an olov, you're a tzaddik, come towards us and atone us. Continues the Gemara, that the next words of the Pasuk is, Vayoshuvu ish midarkei hara, that they repented, and they went back on, and they mended each person midarkei hara, from his bad ways, umin hachomos asher bekapem, and from the robbery, the theft and the robbery that they had in their hands. Says the Gemara, umin hachomos asher bekapem. Well, it already says that they all mended their ways. What were they coming to impress by saying that they also mended their ways, in particular regarding the robbery they had in their hands? What were they referring to? Omar Shmuel, afilu gozal morish. Even if somebody had stolen a beam, ubon oy bebira, and he had built it into his palace, into his tower, into his migdal, mekakea kol abira, he raised down, he would pull down the whole building, kol abira kula, umarzir morish lebailov, and he would return the beam, and they returned the beams to their rightful original owners. And that was the extent of tshuva that the people of Nineveh did. Continues the Gemara. Omar of Adabarava, Odom Shiesh Biyode Aveira, if somebody is guilty of theft, an Aveira, umisvad, and he confesses. Ve'enei choizer bo, but he doesn't retract, he doesn't give back what he's stolen. He doesn't pay for what he's taken away. Lemo doimer, what's he compared to? Laodom shetoifus sherets biyodei. We know sherets are these little animals, these creepy creatures that are tomei just by touching them. And if you touch a sheret, you have to toivel in a mikveh to become pure. What happens if somebody's holding a sheret in his hand, and shafilu toivel b'chol meimis sheba'olam? If whilst you're holding a sheret in your hand, and you toivel, and you're going to mikveh all the waters in the world, le'olto le'tvila, his tefillah is not going to help him. However, zorku miyodo, if you throw away the sherets from you and you let go of it, then kivun shetov al barboim so, if you go into mikvah of just 40 saw of water, miyad also le tefillah, his tefillah is immediately effective and he becomes pure. Shenemer, as it says in the pasuk in Mishli, mechase peshav lo yatzliach umoide. Once he's confessed, va'oizev, and he's forsaken, he's stopped doing the Averus, then Yeruchim, Hashem will have mercy on him. Va'omer, another pasuk says in Eicha, Niso levaveinu el kapoim, in the same way as we lift our hands up to Hashem, our hearts are also being lifted up to Hashem, and we are really conscientiously and seriously mending our ways, and el kil bashamayim, to Hashem in Shemaim, and that is the only way to receive atonement. Continues the Gemara. Omdu betfila, they would daven there in the city square where the teva was. Meiridin lifnei teva zokin chulu, then the elder of the people would go and be the shliach tzibur and represent the whole community, the whole public, with the tfilis. Tonu rabbonon, we learnt in a brisa. Omdu betfila, afal pishiyesh shom zokin v'chacham. So the Braisa says that who's going to be the one to lead the tefillahs, even though there is a zokin, an older person there, and a chacham, and a very wise person, ein meiridin lifnei ateva ela odom harogil. It's important that the person who's leading the tefillahs should be somebody who is an expert, who is proficient with the words, because there's a number of parashiyos and all the extra six brachas that were added, as we saw in the previous Gemara, and somebody who doesn't know and isn't expert enough is going to make a mistake. And we've mentioned previously that somebody who makes a mistake, the representative of the tzibur, of the community, if he makes a mistake, it's a bad sign for the tzibur. And therefore it's important, besides for being a zokin v'chochem, it should be a rogil. As we saw before, it should be a zokin v'rogil. Ezu, rogil, and these words don't really have such, it's not so clear what they mean here. Says the Gemara, Yehuda Omer, that an extra, and this is a brisa continuing, saying that there's added conditions for the perfect shliach tzibur. And that is, he should metupol, he should have children that are dependent on him, ve'ein loy, and he doesn't have a lot of sustenance with which to feed his children, ve'yesh lo yegio basode, and he's his parnosa, his sustenance comes from toiling in the fields, and he needs the rain more than anyone else. Ubeisai Reikom, his home is empty. The Gemara is going to say Beisai Reikom seems to be the same as Ve'einloi, that he doesn't have money in his home. Upirkoi Noe, we'll soon see what the Gemara is going to explain that, but it means that he had a proper youth. We'll soon get back to that. Ushval Berach, and he's humble. Umrutza la'om, and he's acceptable, the people want him to daven for them. V'yeshli ni'imo, he's got a sweet melody in his voice. V'koyle oriv, he's got a pleasant voice. Uboki likris ba'teira, and he's an expert in reading the psukim of Torah. Ubenavim ubeksuvim, because originally they were not allowed to write. Originally the tefillahs, the Torah Nevi'im Ksuvim was written, but they had to be proficiently expert in the psukim, in reading the psukim, pronouncing the words of the psukim, because these brachas were very much coming from the psukim of Torah Nevi'im Uksuvim, and ulashoinois b'medrash, and they should also be expert at the medrashim, ubalochis, ubagodois, halocha and agoda. It's not so clear why this was necessary. Uboki b'kol habrachis kulon, and he should be expert in the formula of all the brachas. V'yovu be'rabonon einayu, and the chachomim, they turned their eyes to Rabbi Yitzchok bar Ami, because he was an individual that fitted the bill exactly. He had all these conditions, and therefore he was the perfect shliach tzibur to represent the community. Continues the Braisa. Well, the Braisa is asking, well, the Gemara is actually asking now, Hainu metupal ve'ein loy, Hainu beisai reikom. What's the difference between metupal ve'ein loy, which means he's got young children that dependent on him and he doesn't have what to feed them with, and beisai reikom, his home is empty? Are they not the same thing? Omer of Chizda, Zeu shebeisai reikom min ha'aveiro. When it says his home is empty, it doesn't mean it's empty from sustenance. It means that his home is empty from theft and robbery, and everything in his home is kosher. As in, it's all his. Continues the Gemara, Upirkei Noah, we saw that it should be somebody who's Upirkei Noah, he should have a proper youth. What does that mean? Omar Abaya, Zeh Shele Yotzele Shem Rabbi Aldusoy, this is somebody whose reputation was straight even when he was younger. Even when he was a Bocha, there was never any bad name that went out against him. Continues the Gemara. And there's a pasuk in Yirmiyah. The pasuk says, "Hoy soli nachlosi, my inheritance was to me ka'arye bayar, like a lion in the forest. Nosno olai bekoilo, that her voice was given against me. Alkein senesio, and that's why I hated her." What does that mean? What does it mean? My nosno olai bekoilo. What is this that her voice was given, so to speak, against me? Why would there be a reason for her voice to come out against me? Omar Marzutra Bar Tuvia, Omar Rav, some say in the name of Rav, Omri la Omar of Chomer Bar Omar Rabbi Elazar, Ze Shliach Tzibur, it's talking about a Shliach Tzibur, somebody who is supposed to be representing the community, Hayered Lifna Teva Sheine Hogun, somebody who's unfit, and he's a wicked person, and he's supposed to be representing everybody when speaking to Hashem, when he himself is wicked and is not doing what Hashem's asking him to do. Against such a person, this voice cries out against them. Continues the Gemara, Va'omer lifneim esrim v'arba brachis. We saw in the Mishnah that the Shliach Tzibur would say an extra six brachis. Shmoyne Esrei Shebechol Yom, 18 brachas, which is a regular Shmoyne Esrei, and as we've mentioned a couple of times, today we have 19, but because the original Shmoyne Esrei was 18, it's called Shmoyne Esrei. Umoysif Aleim Oit Sheish, and he adds on an extra 6 brachas. Asks the Gemara, Hani Sheish, this that you're saying that they add on only 6 brachas, Sheva Havyon. If you look in the Mishnah mentions 7 brachas. Kedetnan, as we saw in the Mishnah, and Ashvias on the 7th bracha, who Oimer, he says, Baruch Merachim al Haaretz. He ends off with a bracha of who has that Hashem has mercy on the land. So it mentions the 7th bracha. Why are you saying he only adds on 6 brachas? And the truth is, when we learned the Mishnah, I explained this. And the source of the way I explained the Mishnah was the answer of the Gemara here. Omer of Nachan by Yitzchok, my Shvias, what does it mean the 7th? It doesn't mean a 7th extra bracha. It means Shvias la'aruka. Because the bracha of Ra'eva on Yenu, which is the 7th bracha of Shmoneh Esrei, that bracha, which is a regular bracha of Shmoneh Esrei, it's one of the 18. But on these fast days, it was an extended bracha. They would add into the bracha some extra words. And therefore, it was the first of 7 brachas that would be extended, that would be added. However, in and of its own, it's not an extra bracha to the Shmoneh Esrei, it's just an extension of an existing bracha. So that's when it says Shvias, it means the 7th of the extended brachas. But the first of the extended bracha is not actually an additional bracha, it's an extension to an existing one. Kedetanya, as we saw in the Braisa, as follows. Begoyel Yisrael, the bracha of Goyel Yisrael that starts Re'eva on Yenu, the 7th bracha of Shmoneh Esrei, Marich, he would lengthen it, he would add on. Ubechaisama, and at the end of the bracha, Hu Oimer, he would say, Mi she'ono es Avraham b'har ha'miria, Hashem who answered Avraham Avinu at har ha'miria, Hu yan eschem should answer you, v'yishma b'kol tzakaschem, and should hear the voice of your cry, Hayoyim azeh this day, Boruch Goyel Yisrael. That's how we would end the bracha, like we end off that bracha today, Boruch Ato Hashem, Goyel Yisrael. V'heinu inin achrav, Amen. And then the community, they're hearing the Shliach Tzibur say this bracha, they say Amen. V'chazan HaKnesses, not to be confused with the Shliach Tzibur. The Chazan HaKnesses is the attendant of the shul. He would say, Tik'u b'nei Aaron, Tik'u. The Kohanim, you should blow the shofar, you should sound a tkia. And it seems from Rashi that he was telling them to sound a tkia, trua tkia. V'chazer v'oimer, and then the next bracha after Goel Yisrael, which is, according to Tanakhama in the Mishnah, it's the bracha of Zichroinois. What would he say at the end of that bracha? He would say, the Shliach Tzibur would say, Mi she'ono es aviseinu al yamsuf, hu yane eschem, v'yishma b'kol tzakaschem ayim azeh, boruch zoicher hanishkochis, which is in the same theme as the bracha of Zichroinois. V'hein oinin achrov omein, and the whole community say omein, after the Shliach Tzibur, v'chazan haKnesses oimer lehem, and now the Chazan says, "Hariu bnei Aaron, hariu." Then the Kohanim, they should sound a trua. You'll notice before it was a tkiyah, here it was a trua, and it seems from Rashi, and that's how the Rambam seems to learn, that they would that the second bracha of these 7 brachas, they wouldn't do a tkiyah trua tkiyah. They would do the trua first, trua tkiyah trua. And that's why this chazan, the attendant, would say, Hariu b'nei Aaron, Hariu. V'chein b'chol brocha and brocha, and this was the sequence with all these 7 brochas. Ba'achas oimer tiku, the first one started with tkiya, and therefore he said tiku. Ba'achas oimer Hariu, and the next one he would say, Hariu, which is a trua first, and then the next one would be a tkiya first, and the next one a trua first. When is it true that the people would answer Omein? Bigvulim, outside the Beis HaMikdosh. Aval b'Mikdosh, but in the Beis HaMikdosh, Eino Kein, there they would not say Omein. Lefisha Eino Einin Omein b'Mikdosh, because in the Beis HaMikdosh, their practice was they would not say Omein. Uminayin she'eino inin omin b'mikdosh. How do we know that the response to a bracha in the Beis HaMikdosh was not Omein? She'nemar, as it says in the Pasuk in Nehemiah. The Pasuk says, Kumu, rise, rise up. Baruchu es Hashem Elokeichem. You should bless Hashem min ha'olam v'ad ha'olam. And this seems in Rashi that what this means is telling, is an instruction on how one would end off a bracha. They would add some words, which is min ha'olam v'ad ha'olam. We'll soon see the exact formula. And then the pasuk continues, Vayvorchu. Vivorchu shem kvaidecha. And this is more, so to speak, facing, turning to Hashem. First, it says Baruch Hu, referring, turning to the people who are saying the brachos, that you should bless Hashem min olam ad olam, and now, so to speak, saying to Hashem, but still speaking to the people, v'yivaruch hu, they will bless you, shem kvoidecho, the name of your glory, umaroy meimal kol brocho, until kol brocho, till on you Hashem are exalted, are beyond, above any brocha and praise. Yochil al kol brochis kulon. We'll soon see exactly what the formula was, but I may have thought that there's a single tehillah, a single response on a list, on a whole list of brachas. Loi te'elo tehillah achas, there would only be a single response, whatever the response is, we'll soon see, but there would only be a single response to a number of brachas. Talmud Lema, that's why it says, umaroimim al kol brocha o tehillah, that al kol brocha, on every single brocha independently, ten loi Tehillah, you should respond with praise to Hashem. We'll soon see what that response was. Ve'elo b'migdosh mahu oimer. What would they say? How would the brachas? How would the shliach tzibur end his brachas, which is associated to kumu baruchu es Hashem elikeichem min ha'olam va'ad ha'olam? And what would the people listening to the bracha? How would they respond? That would have something to do with vivaruchu Hashem kveidech omroimim al kol brachot tehillah. So says the Braisa. Mau Oimer, the Shliach Tzibur would say, Baruch Hashem, the word Elikim doesn't really belong here, but Baruch Hashem, Elikei Yisrael min ha'olam v'ad ha'olam. That's how they would finish the bracha. Baruch Goel Yisrael. So the way the whole bracha would go, the Shliach Tzibur would say as follows. First he would say the whole parasha, that we saw in the Mishnah exactly what they were, and then take the first bracha of these seven. He would say, Misha Ono Es Avram, Hu Yan Eschem Yishmakil Tzakaschem B'yim Azeh, Baruch Ato Hashem, Elokei Yisrael Min Ha'olam V'ad Ha'olam, Baruch Goel Yisrael. And then they would respond. What would they respond? V'hein oinin achra, what would they say? Baruch Shem Kvoid Malchusoi L'olam Void. The blessed is the Shem Kvoid Malchusoi, the name of the glory of your kingdom, L'olam Void, forever and ever. That is how the Shliach, that is what the Tzibur would answer to the Bracha in the Beis HaMikdash. And they would not say Amen. V'chazna Knesses Oimer Lahem. And then this attendant of the Shul there in the Beis HaMikdash vicinity, he would say to the Kohanim, this is the first Bracha, he would say Tiku HaKohanim B'nei Aaron Tiku. He would say sound the Shofar, sound the Tkiah. And then the Kohanim would say, and then the Kohanim would blow Tkiah Teruah Tkiah. But not just yet, the Chayzer, this Chazan, before the Kohanim would blow their Tkiah, the Chayzer V'Omer, the Chazan, this attendant, would repeat some of the words that the Shliach Tzibur had said at the end of the Brachas. Which words? Misha'ono es Avraham Baharim Miriah, Hu Yan Eschem Yishma B'Kil Tzakaschem B'Yoyim Azeh. And that's as far as that first Bracha of Goel Yisrael is concerned. Regarding the next Bracha, which is the one of Zichroinois, so there the Shliach Tzibur says, Baruch Hashem Elokei Yisrael, and he fills in Min Ha'olam V'ad Ha'olam, and then Zoicher HaNishkochis, as we saw before. V'heim, and the community Oinim, they answer Acharav after him, Baruch Shem Kvoid Malchusoi L'Olam Void. That's how they answered, that's how they responded in the Beis HaMikdash to a bracha. V'chazen HaKnesses, the attendant of the shul there in the Beis HaMikdash area, Oimer Lehem, he says to the Kohanim Horiyu, HaKohanim B'nei Aaron Horiyu, since this was the second of the extended brachas, then they would start with a trua, it would be trua tkia, trua, they would say Horiyu, v'chulei. V'chein b'chol brocha, brocha, and so that the same theme continues with all these extra six brachas. Ba'achas Oimer Tiku, with one of them, he says Tiku, he starts with a tkia, Tkia Trua Tkia, Uba'achas Oimer Horiyu, and the next one is a Trua, Trua Tkia, Trua. Atcha Gomer is Kulon until he finishes all those brachas. V'kach Hinig Rav Chalafta, that was the custom of Rav Chalafta, B'tzipuri, V'Rav Chananya Ben Teradyoin, B'sichni. U'kashaba Dava Lifnei Chachomim, and when it came to the Chachomim, to the attention of the Chachomim, that was their custom, and there they were not in the Beis HaMikdash. This was in Sichni or in Tzipuri. Then Omru Loi, the Chachomim said, Loi Hoyu Nagim Kein, Elo Bashari Mizrach ubahar habayis, that they would only in the Har HaBayis and by the Beis HaMikdash, only there they would say Baruch Shem Kvod Malchus HaElam Voed, but outside the area of the Beis HaMikdash, the people would respond with a regular Amen. Ve'isti Omri, Kedetanya, there's another version of a Braisa discussing the same topic. Oimer Lifneim, the Shliach Tzibur says before the community, Esrim V'arba Brochis, 24 Brochis. Shmoina Esri Shebechol Yoim, the regular Shmoina Esra of every day. Umoisif Aleim, and he adds on to them, Oid Sheish, another 6 Brochis. Voison Sheish Heichon Oimron, where does he say these extra 6 Brochis? Bein Goyel, L'Roifei Choyli, between the 7th Brocha of Goyel Yisrael and the 8th Brocha of Rafa'enu. Umarich Begu'ula, and that bracha of Goyel, which is a regular Shmoneh Esrei, he says that bracha, but he extends it, he adds in, as we saw before. V'heino inin achrov omein, and the community at the end of the bracha, they say omein, I'll call bracha or bracha. V'kacho yinoegin begvulim, that was the custom outside the Beis HaMikdash, aval b'migdash, but in the Beis HaMikdash, hoyu oimrim the shliach tzibur, when ending the brachas, would say, Baruch Hashem Elokei Yisrael min ha'olam v'ad ha'olam, Baruch Goyel Yisrael. And in the Beis HaMikdash, they would not respond by saying Amen. As we saw before, they would say, Baruch Shem Kvod Malchusoi La'olam Voed. Why would they not say Amen in the Beis HaMikdash? Lifi she'ein oinin Amen b'migdash, u'minayin she'ein oinin Amen b'migdash? What would be the source that one does not say Amen in the Beis HaMikdash? Shenemar, as it says in the Pasuk, and we already mentioned this before, that Kumu Borachu es Hashem Elokeichem min ha'olam ad ha'olam. When saying the bracha, then before the end of the bracha, the one would say Baruch Hashem Elokei Yisrael min ha'olam v'ad ha'olam. Vivorchu Shem Kvoidecha umroimom al kol bracha tehila. That means that the Klal Yisrael, the community, will respond by saying Baruch Shem Kvoid Malchus ha'olam v'ad. Al kol bracha bracha, for each and every bracha that they heard, ten lo tehila, they would give a praise to Hashem. Continues the Gemara, yet another braisa, Tonu Rabbonon. Al harishonos, on that first bracha of Re'eva Onyenu, of Goyel Yisrael, who oimir Baruch Hashem Elokei Yisrael min ha'olam v'ad ha'olam, Baruch Goyel Yisrael. V'heinoinu machrov, and the community answer after him, Baruch Shem Kvod Malchus ha'olam v'ad. V'chazon ha'kneses, and the attendant of the shul, oimir says, Tiku Kehanim Tiku, that the Kehanim should blow a tkiya trua tkiya. V'choizer v'oimir, and the Chazan, not the Shliach Tzibur, the Chazan, and it seems that this is even before the Kohanim actually do the blowing of the shofar, then the Chazan repeats a section of the end of the bracha that the Shliach Tzibur says, V'oimir misha'onos Avram b'har emiriyah, hu yane eschem, Hashem who answered Avram Avinu should answer you, v'yishma b'kol tzakaschem mayim hazeh, and should listen to the sound of your cry on this day, v'hein teiken emirin v'teiken, and then the Kohanim would blow. The next bracha, the first of the extra 6 brachas, who Oimir, Baruch Hashem Elokei Yisrael min ha'olam v'ad ha'olam, Baruch Zoicher Hanishkochis. That's how he would end that bracha. It's the bracha of Zichronos, as we saw in the Mishnah. V'heinoin im achrov, the community would answer, Baruch Shem Kvod Malchus ha'olam v'ad. V'chazon ha'kneses, the attendant of the shul, Oimir would say, Hariu b'nei arin hariu. He would tell the Kohanim to sound a trua tkiya trua. V'oimir, and the Chazan, before the Kohanim blow, the Chazan would say a section of the end of the bracha, Misha ono es aviseinu, al yamsuf uyan eschem yishma b'keil takaschem hayoim hazeh. V'heim, and then the Kohanim would be marim v'toikin amarim, they would do the trua tkiya trua, because this is the second of the 7 brachas. V'chein b'chal bracha bracha, and the same continues with all these 6/7 brachas, ba'achas oimer tiku, or ba'achas oimer hariu. With one of them, he starts with the tkiya, the other one starts with the trua, at shi'igmer es ha'brachas kulon, until he finishes all the brachas. V'chein hinig rev chalafta b'tzipuri, rev chanani ben tradyoin b'sichni, as we saw before, u'kishabo dover itzel chachomim, when the chachomim heard about this, omru, they said, lo'yhoyu noegin kein elu b'shari mizrach, u'b'har ha'bayis, they would only have this custom of not saying Amen, just saying Baruch Shem Kvod Malchusoi, and that the bracha ending with Baruch Hashem Elokei Yisrael min ha'olam v'ad ha'olam, that was only a practice in the Beis HaMikdash, not outside the Beis HaMikdash. Continues the Gemara, and this takes us back to the Mishnah. Rabbi Yehuda Omer, Rabbi Yehuda says that the first 2 of the 6 brachas was not Zichronos and Shofreis. Rabbi Yehuda Omer, lo hayu tzorich leimar Zichronos and Shofreis. sins. V'chulei. Says the Gemara, Omer Rab Adda de min Yafi, Rab Adda from Yafi would say, my Tamud Rab Yehuda, what would be the source and reason for Rab Yehuda? Lefi she'ein oimrim zechreinis v'sheifreis, Rab Yehuda held that one only ever says the bracha of zechreinis and sheifreis, elo b'reish Hashanah, only on Reish Hashanah, as we saw in Reish Hashanah d'Avta Zayin, u'b'yevleis, and on the Yom Kippur of Yovel, as we saw in the Mishnah on Rosh Hashanah Dav Chavav, u'b'shas milchoma, and at some point when they were going out to war, then they would say the Zechreinus and the Shofreis. It's not so clear exactly when they would say that, but they would say these Zechreinus and Shofreis when they went out to war. But besides for that, even when they had the fast days, they would add on other prokim, other psukim, and these six brachas, but according to Rabbi Yehuda, they would not say the Zechreinus and the Shofreis. And in Yiras Hashem, in the next year, we're going to continue from here.